Greetings to all of you. Very good afternoon and morning in different places. Myself, Nitendra Singh, as you all know. Those who don't know, just for the introduction. Today I'm going to present with the topic of 3D printing. And I'll be covering few basics of printing and 3D printing, and along with that I'll go to some applications in day-to-day life and for advanced techniques, advanced applications, so to say, in different world. So let's begin. Okay. So printing, as you know, it's a part of our life from the beginning. We started printing long back. As you can see on your screens, there are various kind of printing techniques which evolved with time, and initially with like stamp printing, with wood printing, followed by the printing press, and followed by digital printing. Nowadays we have a very advanced digital printing for photos and stuff, and very latest called as 3D printing. So what is printing basically? So this is printing. This is what it looks like. So if we go to the basic of printing, what we basically use, like initially we had some blocks which we used to just dip in the ink and just print it. And similarly, in nowadays, when we talk about printing of digital printing or the printers you see all around, the Xerox machine and all sort of thing, you just send a command or whatever you want to print through a digital signal, and on paper you receive a beautiful image or text or whatever you see. So basically, what printing looks to the machine is something like this. So on your left, if you see, there is a grid which is like an array of different squares with signal with the marking of 1, 2, 3, 4 on the bottom, and A, B, C, D on left-hand side going up. So this is basically a grid, I must say, which represent your area or the thing which is to be printed. So when you send something to the printer, it basically divides that thing into these sort of square arrays, which we call as pixels. You all must know you have this 2 megapixel, 12 megapixel cameras in your phone, which is like 10 power 6 pixels on your phone, which your camera can capture. So for example, if you take this 2D image printing, so when you send an image to the PC or to the device, it basically divides it into this sort of grid and assign a particular address to dedicated pixel. So in this case, for example, you see, so the image of J, the letter J, is basically divided in the way it has shown on the grid. And you can see, like, it has given a dedicated address. How you can see? You can see, follow the green colors. So if you follow the top, it's like G3. It's a one thing, then G4, G5, G6, then F5. And in this manner, you can follow a dedicated thing which is to be printed on the paper or on the device. So if you take the print out of this, so the printer will know that where it has to put the ink, basically. So the thing which you used to do before, using the blocks or some stamp, dedicatedly knowing where you have to put this stamping or putting the ink by the printer, is basically done in this manner. So this is a very, very small example. So if you want to print, for example, a photo, and you have took a selfie of yourself by your 12 megapixel camera, so then your entire face will be then divided by the software of your phone into 12 into 10 power 6 small pixels, and each color of your face of different areas will be divided into different shade of color to different pixel, and that's how it will print your face in a photo in this manner. So this is basically called as 2D printing. Why 2D? Because you have only two dimension. When you have a face, if you see your face, you have this width, this height, and also this depth. But when you take a photo, you can just see your width and your height. So just two dimension you see. So this is basically a representation of your face in two dimension. Or we can say just one slice. You just see one slice of your face. So this is called 2D printing. When we talk about 3D printing, we basically get, along with this one slice, we also get different slices of your face in this manner. So, for example, if one J here on your screen, if you see there J, if one such film, I will say it alpha on the middle image, if you see there are slices. If this one slice I say as alpha, and I keep putting 2, 3, 4, 5, and up to 8 more slices, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, and make one palette like this, then you can see I earlier had only 1, 2, 3, and ABCDF. Now I also have this alpha, beta, gamma in 3D. So when I take this as an image, I will also get the depth, which you can see on your right. On your right, if you see the 3D image of J, this is how it looks like. Along with the face, it also has a depth, if you can see. So this is basically the difference between 2D and 3D printing, and this is how we achieve it logically, how we achieve it in this manner. So we all now know what is 3D printing. What it is? It is basically a form of additive manufacturing. Like you add one layer, then you add two layer, three layer, and that's how you basically get one image in 3D. And this is basically done by you take a photograph of a image, for example. Here you design this in a 3D softwares. You design this tool in all 3D modeling. You design all the aspects, then you slice it in those alpha, beta, and these sort of thing. And then you command your printer to print each 2D photo on one above the other. And that's how you basically get the regenerative 3D image or 3D object, because that's how you call it as. So there are different kind of 3D tools which are used. I'll explain them. I'll name few of them in the end. And on your right and bottom side, if you see, that's the image of a 3D object which you really want to print. And on top of it, if you see, it's an example of how a 3D printer basically keep printing from one side to other to regenerate one 3D object. The principle, what you can print basically using 3D printing. How do you think that can we print anything? So the answer lies in this manner. So the principle of 3D printing basically depends on two things. I have just divided it into layman's language in two things. One, it's a sticky layer nature. For example, if I put one layer and if I put another layer, if it has some sort of interaction and sticky behavior, like 1, 2, 3, then I can print it. But if it doesn't have this sort of behavior, then we cannot print it. For example, if I put a paper or a wood, take a wood, you have a wood log, you put another wood log, you put another wood log, then what you will get? It will just tumble down because it cannot stay there without any sticking mechanism. On the other hand, if you have a wax, the candle, the wax, you have poured one hot wax, then it got dry, you put another hot wax, Then you let it dry, you put another hotfix. It keep on adding. It stay there. So if any material having such a sticky layering property, if it can stick with the layer below, by any mechanism, we'll discuss the mechanism in a while, then we can print it. Second thing is the change of state. If this material or this layer which we want to use for printing anything, if it changes its state from liquid to solid, from powder to solid, or any this manner, then basically we can print it. For example, as I told you, if you put a wax, the hot wax is liquid, you have seen. If you pour it will be liquid, but as soon as it fall down, it solidifies due to its solidification temperature. So basically, if it changes the state, then yes, of course. If these two things are there, then we can 3D print any object using that sort of material. So change of state can be possible due to two reasons. One, due to temperature. For example, there is a phase change taking place. The liquid material is basically converting to solid, or somehow we are fusing something, we are converting some solid powder into melt and then re-solidifying it to solid. So change of state due to temperature. We provide some energy, we bring the change in temperature, and then so we can have a change of state with temperature. Second, chemically, if you pour something and due to some chemical reactions, it changes its state. For example, concrete. If you pour the concrete, after a while it gets solidified. So of course you can use concrete for 3D printing something, because when it due to its chemical interaction with the chemicals which are already inside the concrete and water, it solidifies. So you can have this basically these two sort of things which you can use to generate any kind of 3D printed object using such materials. So very slight and very day-to-day examples you can understand with. The question is, how do we do it? You have understood you need this thing, you have understood you need that thing, you understood the basic concept, but how we basically do it? So there are many processes of doing it depending on what kind of material you really want to make or what you want to print, so to say. So on the left-hand side, there are the name of processes which we called as material extrusion, wet polymerization, material jetting, powder bed fusions, basically for polymers, binder jetting, and powder bed fusion, basically for metals. So these are basically the main processes which are involved in order to get the 3D printed objects. And the technology, the machines or the processes, the technology or the machines which you use to do them are on your right. Namely, the fused deposition modeling, which is mainly known as FDM. I'll discuss a few of them in a while. Stereolithography, SLA, digital light processing, DLP, masked stereolithography, MSLA, drop on demand, material jetting, selective laser sintering, sand binder jetting, metal binder jetting, direct metal laser sintering, selective or called sometimes called as selective laser melting, and electron beam melting. So depending on what you really want to print, accordingly you use which technique you should use to print it. So let's discuss how we basically do it. What are the main way to do it? For example, material extrusion. So what you basically do, you basically 3D print this in this process. You have some, say for example, you take thermoplastic material, which is like the plastic material which you can heat, and it become like the waxy material, and you can just turn it around to get any object and these things like that. So you have some heated nozzle, which you can see there is a nozzle on. You pour the plastic material through it, and it follows the the grid which you the grid design which you have already given in your 3D software, which has already given how to do it, and then it just passes ASS and keep on printing. So this is how you receive you get one 3D printed object using this material extrusion processes. And one of the example of this is fused deposit modeling, FDM. So FDM is basically one of the most commonly and most widely used technique. And as I mentioned, it uses the filament of solid thermoplastic material, which is pushed through the heated nozzle. As I mentioned you, I showed you in the previous slide. And the printer recurringly deposits the material on a platform and then keep moving upward. And each layer, it's there. It solidifies, it interacts with previous layer. Again, layer by layer by layer, it keep on going. So this is a short video just to see how you achieve it. Groot, if everyone knows you. So you can see, start with the base formation, and then layer by layer it keep on adding. This is the feeding of plastic material. So in this sort of printing, you need a base on which you basically make this object. The second process is wet polymerization. As I told you, this is mainly for polymers, which are like castable and high temperature polymers, which you use for different applications. So in this case, what we do, we use a resin, like resin here, if you can see, it's a resin here, and then we selectively pass a light to this, which you light or laser, you can say in this case, and then it keep on building. The laser chemically changes its shape into solid thing, and we retrieve this sort of object as you go up. So this is the laser, if you can see, we can just pass it directly to this, and we get this sort of thing. And there are a few examples of this, as I mentioned, stereolithography, DLP, and mask stereolithography. These are the name of techniques. But I want to cover stereolithography because it has an interesting thing. SLA or stereolithography, SLA, is basically the world's first 3D printing technology. And it was basically invented by Chuck Hull in 1986 or 1980. Basically, Chuck Hull started the 3D printing in 1984 and 1986, exactly, I don't remember the date. And he is the one who has the patent of this technology. And then later on, he started his own company and stuff like that. So basically, it uses a mirror, which is like a galvanometer mirror, and it reflects your laser lights to the resin. And if you can see, it's like in the object, you put the resin here and it reflects in the laser light in the direction of image which is already created, and then you get the object done. And DLP is also another kind of similar to SLA. The only difference is that it uses the digital light projector to flash the light instead of mirrors. So more or less same, but more advanced, so to say. So these are very commonly used techniques, which use for for resin polymers to print the objects. There are another method called material jetting, which is mainly for a new different kind of like instead of resin, you want to put a droplet of a material on a selective deposition. Like you can see here, you use the resin, but instead of in resin formation, you put it from outside. You like the previous method, like FDM, you pour it from the outside to get the image, get the object. The examples are material jetting and on drop on demand. Drop on demand basically just like if you have something and you want to create some gap as well, so you can stop and you can stop, something like this. Another method is power bed fusion polymers, which is mainly for the metal printing. So the question is, you can do printing in two manner. So you can one melt the metal and then pour it, but that is very risky because metal are very very the melting temperature is very high and very difficult to maintain them in this precise manner. So instead, what you do, you make the powder of it, and in the powder bed, you use the laser to selectively heat that interaction region, and it locally melts that and fuse it. So it's like powder which is converted into molten thing using the laser and then fuse it. So that's how you get all the metal objects, 3D printed metal object or 3D printed alloys, the objects which are made up of alloys. And very very common example these days, you will find like low melting metals of stainless bronze or silica casting you do sometimes, and also some aluminium you do using this sort of technique. Binder jetting is another example of this thing where you use the liquid bonding agent selectively to like bind the regions of powder bed. So somehow you basically pour the chemical liquid, so to say, which chemical interacts with that and gives a solid object to that. So this is a process which is also used for sand or silica or this sort of thing, and also for metals. So this is another way of producing the metal parts, and also for sand castings. This is another powder bed fusion dedicatedly for metals. So here we use the laser thing to melt the specific design or specific area to melt the powder boundaries, to convert it into melt, and then basically fusing it to form a solid metal body. And this is very unique because it uses the high the precision is high. You have high energy and like very penetrating low diameter thing to make it more precise. Yeah, here one point I want to mention. When I say low radii or low diameter beam, which means that imagine the first image which we were talking about, the grid. So if when you have this big grid, you can have a very vague finish, but if you have a large number of pixels, you can have a fine finish. Large number of pixels means you should have a small square, small array. So here, if we have a fine beam, the finer the beam, the finer the finish of the final object. So in these two techniques, like selective laser and electron beam melting, these are very fine tips or very fine lasers which we can use to have the finished metal materials. So there are few softwares, or we call it as tools, which are used for 3D printing. On your left, you have a 3D modeling softwares like SolidWorks, CATIA, AutoDesk Fusion, and Autodesk 123D design, so where you create your 3D model, whichever you want to print, you basically design it in 3D in those softwares. And then you have a slicer and 3D printer host, which basically take this image, slice it down in like chuck, 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 and then feed each slice to the printer to print it, to the printer. And so one slice printed, another slice printed, and that's how you get the image. You can, yeah, one more thing. You can get the object from bottom to top and sometimes top to bottom, depending on different techniques. So sometimes you may receive a vase from like standing position, and sometimes you may receive a vase inverted. You may have to, so depending on which technique you are using, you will get your object in that manner. So some applications I should discuss. 3D printing is basically used in many areas these days. And one of the very unique and very important area is medical industry, so to say. So let me cover from right side. On the right hand side, you can see there is a custom made prosthetics. So if you know those for, if you need some sort of prosthetic, for your body part, then it is easy nowadays to scan your, for example, another part, and then you feed it to the software. It will create the exactly same thing. It not only helps in the user to stay comfortable with, like it's more comfortable to use and to wear, and also it gives you the right balance to your body while. If you are having, for example, here in this case, you have a leg. So if you have a like exact same design and dimension of which you had earlier, or which you can have from your own body, then you can have a balance on your body is rather easily to maintain. It's like exactly similar. Secondly, the complex areas which of joint, for example, here you can see, which was difficult to make before because of its intrication. Those intricate details you can print and you can create here using 3D printing. So this is one of the example of 3D printing in your day-to-day life and in medical industry. On your left, if you see, you can bioprint tissues and organoids these days. In the middle, I would say that creating such patient-specific organ replicas. Now, surgeons basically use to practice before performing any complicated operation. For example, there is a heart surgery or there is a valve surgery in your heart. Then, and sometimes it is very much connected to your brain or something like this. Then it's very, very complex to treat it on these platforms. So what surgeons nowadays do that they create these sort of images, these sort of objects, they practice this before and then do the actual operation. This increases the efficiency and it reduces the possibility of further traumas and all. And this type of procedure has already been performed successfully in surgeries from starting from face transplants to spinal procedures, and also in some cases they have also tried for like brain and heart, of course. And also you can print surgical instruments. Like sometimes you need a specific tool to for some specific surgeries. You can have this sort of surgical instruments being 3D printed and can be used for any specific treatment. Along with that, you can have the day-to-day objects printed of using 3D printing. And a very nice example, which I feel like, is the ceramic and clay printing. So on your right, you can see you can have the clay pot printing using this 3D printing technique, and you can also have ceramic artifacts. So along with this, so this is something like you can use for, of course, for your decorations and some useful stuff. Along with that, It has a very, very unique application, so to say. In industry, sometimes you need heating elements. And those heating elements are made up of alumina and silicon carbide and things like that, which has a very fragile material. For example, if you hold a silicon carbide, it just breaks down. And you use those heating elements in big, big furnaces to heat up to temperature of 1800 degrees Celsius, 22 degrees 100 Celsius, something like that. And if it is so delicate, so you, the integrity is very, very, you lose it very, very, very quickly. And because of this, your maintenance cost and your delay in maintaining the furnaces in industry, it causes a huge loss. So you can use these sort of technique to fabricate those intricate filaments of ceramic. And so using the conventional technique, you can have the only a tubular or these sort of designs which are fragile. But if you use this sort of technique, you can put in internal reinforcement to those filaments, and it's more stable, more robust, and has a long life during the production. So just ceramics and clay, not only for the decoration, but also for industrial applications. Next, very interesting. We can now have a 3D printed houses. Yes. You can see on your left, it was like a very initial, first of its kind of a house, which was designed and created by one of the company. If I remember the name was, I don't get the name, but you can go to iconbuild.com where you will find the details of many things, or you can Google it simply. So you can have this sort of houses. What is the benefit of this? Why we need 3D printed houses? So the cost is very less, if you see. Or if you want to make some modular houses, for example, if you want to set up one township in a remote area, or if you want to settle some location after some natural calamity or something like that, then you can like create these modular houses in a remote location. You just transport it, something like that. So you can have like quick and more efficient way of making a house. And it's not like the first image on your left is very primitive kind, and you can say, oh, this is very old design and stuff like that, but don't think so. On your right, we have the image which is one of the artist's image, which is old. I'm sure must be somewhere you'll find that sort of 3D printed house very soon. And you can also, like here you can see there is a combination of concrete in one side, and the front is made up of glass. So of course there is a possibility that you make the structure and then you put the glass. But if you use some sort of physics and some sort of metallurgical advancement, so it is quite possible to manufacture glass like that, or you can make glass in different designs on different intrication as well. So yeah, this is the example of our day-to-day application of 3D printing. This is my favorite, the food industry. So yeah, you can see the first image, it's pizza, but no, not yet. Pizza, not yet. We can print the 3D print pizza. And wait, just a moment. All right. So yes, you can 3D print the pizza. You can 3D print the cake. Mainly, you can 3D print the objects which are mainly based on sugar or gluten, maybe. So because you have some sort of thing, as I mentioned, phase change. You have some sort of, say, flour, which is flour made in. You pour it down, you heat it down, it will keep on giving you the base. Or if you have a sugar, which is like you can pour it down, it will give you the base and you can create it. So yeah, it is possible. So it has some pros and cons, of course. The pros is like it has more sustainability, like you can use meat or something in a more sustainable manner. It's more, the wastage and everything is pretty less. You can use it very efficiently. And it is very comfortable to produce for space, though for the astronauts. When they go, it's very, very easy to like print it cleanly and maintain it and send it to them. And the cons are like the tolerance needed to achieve this is very low. But yes, we cannot have so many products out of this so far, maybe in future, definitely. And the production is very slow, of course, and the cost is pretty high. So maybe for the timing, the food robots are doing better compared to food 3D printed foods. Safety, yes. Safety is one concern, that everything should be in a clean environment. So when you do this to maintain the clean environment and things like that, the cost definitely becomes higher. So food industry, yes. Very interesting. The aerospace application. So all those airline related and aerospace people who are very much interested in these sort of areas, here it is. You can basically have a 3D printed parts for the aerospace technology, for aircraft, for spaceships, for engines and things like that. There are many companies who are working in this direction, and they have achieved quite a good results. And what are the benefits of having the 3D printed parts for the aerospace? So I have listed a few. Less weight. Because of this technique, you use very less wastage and things like that. So you also reduce you can use like different alloys to make this sort of thing. So during the 3D printing, since you don't need to add extra, because sometimes it's difficult to machine something, okay? So you can just machine some sort of part, some extra material is still there. But here you don't need, if you need a ring within the ring, for example, you just directly print it inside. So the excess material, which used to be there earlier, can be avoided here. You can have more, very less. So around 40 to 60% weight reduces when we use a 3D printed part. And this directly helps in reducing the sleek design of your aircraft, sleeker, slimmer, more aerodynamics, and less fuel consumption, of course. So, and of course, you saved a lot of material. Functional integration. So when this process allows that, when you have a, say, lock and joint connection, you can make these two integrate part in a very, very precise manner. So the integration is pretty, it's a plus point. And it gives better quality to this. You can make complex parts, as I mentioned, in case of medical engineering as well. Sometimes you have a complex geometry which are difficult to machine and make. These sort of part you can make on using the 3D printing technology. And of course, as I mentioned, significant cost reduction, because the tools, manufacturing additive tools, are like doesn't require so much of things to do, and also you save the material, you save a lot of things, so the cost is very low in this case. And you can plan your production in a better manner. You have industry compliant material and strength you can have using a specific material for the specific use. And this also lowers the emission of carbon dioxide, which is a concern these days for the climate issue. So somehow you are having more benefits at a lesser cost. Very Recently, everyone has seen the SpaceX mission for NASA. So just to tell you that the helmets which these astronauts were wearing were 3D printed. Small video. Yeah, so we can use this technology for making many such components and part for our space missions. This is one example. And what we achieved with this, like the weight of your suit was like reduced and it was more comfortable for the astronauts. And likewise, there are many, many parts you can create for spaceships, for ISS, of course. And that's how you are reducing the cost of travel and also you are increasing the reliability of the product. And one of my favorite application is the nuclear industry. So recently, very recently, the Oak Ridge National Lab of US and a team there, basically, they developed a 3D printed nuclear reactor core. So, you know, in a nuclear reactor, you have a core where you put all your fuel, basically the uranium and all, which reacts and that gives the energy, which boils the waters around, and then you can generate the electricity. So this core is basically a very, very complex thing, very complex. And if you go for the complexity, then you somehow have to compromise with the neutronics or some scientific and engineering aspect of it. So it's like a feedback thing. You have to somehow compromise because of this complex design. You cannot go beyond some limits, due to which you have some limitation of achieving, like if you can, from nuclear, you can achieve as much amount you want, but we are limited by the engineering and scientific issues which are related to this. So if we can reduce this, or you can achieve this the complex design, you can harness more energy out of it. So that's what, and of course they are more safer because the more number of parts increases more uncertainties. One single print body which is printed like this, no moving part, which is better. So yeah, this is something new, very new. So this recently ORNL did this, and is quite remarkable to say. And the emissions of ORNL are like, they want to design actual reactor size 3D printed nuclear reactor core, and they for this they want to scale it up their facility of using additive manufacturing to achieve like big massive meter by meter size of core. And also the reliability and consistency in printing these components. Because for example, if you make one reactor, if you want to make another reactor, core should have the same thing. Because if you change the design, then of course, all sort of associated things get changed and things like that. So they are working in it. And it's very interesting, as well as it's very challenging. Why challenging? Of course, manufacturing, because you have to, the core is very intricate to design, and you can achieve this, but to do it on such a scale is still a challenge for them, which is yet to be done, yet to be achieved. And why? Because they are also having issues with material. So just an example, you cannot just 3D print core by using any material. There are specific material, only those material can be used to design a core or to have a core of it. So we need to have a technology which can work in both manner. The 3D printing, which can be done for those specific material. And of course, if we cannot achieve completely with those material, we need to somehow tweak some material engineering to get some sort of a 3D printable material in that manner or something like this. This will affect the nuclear science and engineering part of it. As I mentioned, the material within the core, within the reactor, plays a big role in deciding many aspects of nuclear science and engineering and harnessing the electricity out of it. So we need to evaluate how safe it is, how safely it should be done, how precisely it should be done. And for that, they are doing a high performance computing and data analytics, because to achieve this intricacy, you need a lot of data to design and to slice it down, as I said. So it's a challenge in itself. Still, they are pretty hopeful, and I really appreciate it that the lab aims to operate its first of its kind, like fully 3D printed reactor by 2023. And I hope, I really wish if they can do it. I think they can do it. It's a very, very robust technology these days, and people are working collectively on this. So this is very, very interesting and very new application which I found recently. And of course, apart from all these applications, you can have application of 3D printing in other day-to-day lives, like in fashion industry, in all sort of different things. Wherever you can find the stickiness and the layer possibility of printing something, you can use 3D printing technology. So with this word, I hope you have enjoyed it. I would like to thank you, and stay safe. And if you have some questions, I would be happy to answer a few of them. Let me see. Oh, we have a lot of questions. Yeah, let me read some of them. Okay, the question says, like, any idea how durable are the 3D printed prosthetic limbs? Yeah, of course, the reliability is pretty high, I must say, and they are equally, or I must say, they are more reliable than the conventional ones, because as I mentioned, that in the conventional, it's very difficult to have the complex design and complex design of your body parts, which you can basically print it using this design, this technique, and they are more reliable, I must say. They are more reliable. And if you don't believe me, you can go to any doctor and you can ask. They are more reliable. Okay, so there's another question. Can multiple metals or different materials can be used simultaneously for 3D printing for complex application? This would be amazing, and of course we can do. For example, in pizza, I told you, you use different sort of thing. You can have cheese, you can have this thing, but yeah, on a serious note, yes, you can do so. As I told you, there are techniques which I mentioned and I covered in my presentation, where you use the powder thing and you put a laser beam to, especially for metals, so use different powder material and you use this thing. So if you can have a different layer of powder, so to say, which are needed for a different layering of materials, so you can fine tune your laser program accordingly. You can keep one layer of a specific material, use a dedicated laser time or laser energy. When you change the transition from one material to another material powder, you change the energy of a layer accordingly, and then you can have a multiple metals in a different or different materials in one go. This is like in layered process. But if you have, for example, if you're talking about the mixture of materials, then this is basically an alloy. Then instead of this thing, you can use the alloy powder directly and can get anything you want. There is another question. Are there ways to add nanoparticle reinforcers like graphene oxide and improve strength of polymers like polylactic acids. Yeah, you can use, but like if you are asking like a complex polymer related interactions, then I would say I will not go in detail because I'm not the expert of these chemical interactions for polymers. But yes, graphene is used basically for 3D printing. And as you know, graphene is a very different and very advanced material, very effective, and a lot of research and applications are coming to it, and it's been used. So of course you can use graphene for something. In one more thing you can do using this technique, for example, if you have some sort of thin pipe, so to say, and you want to reinforce it using something, then you can use for example, like graphene or something sort of reinforcement within that, and you can just fix it because both are light material. Because you wanted to have a pipe, thin pipe, because of so that you can make it light, reduce the weight, but you need metal finish something, so you use the reinforcement to increase the strength. So somehow you have both the things. So yeah, this is one. I hope I am answering your questions. If not, you can still comment on it. There's one more question. How 3D printing is helpful for us? Yes, it is very helpful. All these examples which I have given are from day-to-day life, and I think you all can go through the application, and you can see it's pretty much helpful for all of us. And as we increase the use of this technique in our day-to-day life, it will reduce the cost as well. It will increase it will increase the technology in more precise manner. For example, just one example, like before we used to have a black and white camera. We used to get pictures on black and white, but nowadays we have a digital, very sharp image cameras, because now people are using more of it. So as the utilization will increase, the people will come with more and more better, like they will put a lot of input to it for its betterment, and we'll have a better applications and better use in our day-to-day life. No, this for clay pots, we are using casting processes. Yes, 3D process will costly for clay pot industry. How we can enhance the use of 3D printing? So if you see, the casting takes time. The time is the factor which reduces the cost of 3D printing in that sense. Because the casting takes time, and 3D printing is much faster compared to the casting in this case. And also, it's using, as I mentioned, you can make intricate things with this technology, which is like quite complex in casting. Who invented the first 3D printer? As I mentioned, Chuck Hull. Chuck Hull invented the. I mentioned this in 1984 or 1986. He invented this thing, and the SLO technique was the first which he used for this thing. Oh, do. Is 3D printing used for fabrication of super capacitors? So far I have no idea. But maybe they can use it if the material, because super capacitors are of different material. If you can use these sort of, if I understand correctly, you need a specific material for capacitor manufacturing. And if that is usable with this technique, of course people must be using. I am not aware of it yet. I'm so sorry. I'll look for it. And how big can be the dimension of an object printed using this? using printed through this printer. So the printer is not like our day-to-day small printer. The printer is like you can have like big massive printer, you can have a small printer. So as I mentioned, you can make the entire house using 3D printer. So if you try to visualize this printer, it's nothing but depending on the material you are using, you can have one dropping arm, so to say, a nozzle, big nozzle. For example, if you want to make a house, then you will have a big nozzle of concrete, which is somewhere mechanically connected to one concrete plant. This entire big nozzle will now move in meters of dimension to create the house, something like this. But on the other end, if you want to, for example, you have seen the video of this Groot. So it's a small object. So for that, you need some small nozzle, small area just to do it. And for example, if you want to print, say, button, you have like button printed like this. So you can have a very small application for this. So you can put like just like this button. So you can have a range from small printing nozzle to a big house scale printer. So in meters, so to say, from millimeters to meters, you can have any sort of this thing. So yeah, I must say this is the end of our series, which was running for this entire week. And I thank all of you to join us and to be a part of Indian Youth Nuclear Society. And I really encourage you to visit our website, which is like IYNS.in. And you can register there. Our registrations are open. You can follow us on all the social media, like on Facebook, on Instagram, and on Twitter. And of course, on YouTube channel, you can subscribe, you can like, and the registrations are free. So you can come with us, you can join in. Yeah, so one more thing, the registrations are open for a limited time, the free registration. So grab it and stay safe. This is a tough time. I would still say stay safe, maintain the hygiene, and take care. Thank you. See you. Bye-bye.